Welcome to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute is building an interfaith coalition to defend the family. We believe the best for children is mothers and fathers who cooperate in a lifelong union of love, surrounded by a culture that supports these aspirations. You can count on the Ruth Institute to know what they're talking about, and you can count on Dr. J to help you put your faith into action and make a difference. This week, we bring in an expert who will help you defend the truth about marriage and family and human sexuality. And now, for Dr. J's personal interview with Father Carter Griffin.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to this episode of the Dr. J Show. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest today is Father Carter Griffin. Father Griffin is a priest of the Archdiocese of Washington, D.C. He was raised a Presbyterian and converted to Catholicism while attending Princeton University. After graduating in 1994, he served 4 years as a line officer in the United States Navy prior to entering the seminary. He attended Mount St. Mary's Seminary in Emmitsburg, Maryland for 2 years of philosophy, followed by the North American College in Rome for 5 years of theology. Father Griffin was ordained to the priesthood in 2004. He served as a priest secretary for 3 years before beginning doctoral studies in Rome in 2008. He wrote his dissertation on the subject of priestly celibacy. After completing his doctorate and serving as parochial vicar at St. Peter's Parish on Capitol Hill, in 2011, he was appointed Director of Priestly Vocations for the Archdiocese of Washington. He's also Vice Rector of the St. John Paul II Seminary, and now he serves as the rector. He's the author of Why Celibacy? Reclaiming the Fatherhood of the Priest, which is the book we're going to be talking about today. Father Griffin, thank you so much for joining me. I'm very excited to get acquainted with you.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here too. Thank you.
Now, it turns out that when I reverted to the Catholic faith, I was teaching at George Mason University. So, and at that time, people referred to it as the Catholic University of Northern Virginia, because there were so many Catholic students out there at that big old state university. And Father Bob Selinsky brought me back to the faith. And most of the priests that I encountered during the years that I was still in that area were trained at the Mount St. Mary's in Emmitsburg. And there's a very distinctive style of preaching and everything about that seminary. Yeah. So that's a very wonderful connection. I mean, I feel like I know you already.
It's a great seminary. I spent 2 wonderful years there. And in fact, I was just there recently visiting our current seminarians who are at the Mount, and the place is thriving.
That's great. Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. So glad to hear that. So you've got a book about priestly celibacy, and the Ruth Institute is an interfaith coalition to defend the family. We have followers all over the world, and we have followers of all different religious persuasions, but they all agree that the family matters, and most of them are biblical in one way or the other. So I wonder if we could just start, Father Griffin, by you telling us what is the biblical foundation for the concept of clergy celibacy.
Sure. And maybe I can anticipate and go back even a little bit before that and say, I think that there's even kind of a natural understanding of celibacy in most cultures. And we can see that not only in different religions, but also just at a very natural level, there was an understanding until really fairly recently that many people would embrace celibacy, not get married for the sake of some other good, sometimes very natural goods, taking care of parents and so forth. So, I mean, just to kind of put it into a context where even at a very natural level, there is an understanding that perhaps celibacy can sometimes be not only accepted, but actually very beautiful. In the biblical context, it takes on a very particular light. In the Old Testament, we see the beginnings of prophetic, where you see examples of prophetic celibacy, although in sort of ending actually with John the Baptist, who was a celibate. We know now from the evidence of the Dead Sea Scrolls that the Qumran community and the other Essene kind of culture there's a strong emphasis on celibacy. And in the New Testament, we know that Jesus himself lived that charism of celibacy. I mean, in his case, it was a choice of celibacy for the sake of his ministry, but that many others, including St. Paul himself, lived celibacy. And our understanding of the early church. Increasingly, scholars recognize that at the very beginnings, there were already this very strong movement towards celibacy, or at least perpetual continence in the case of married clergy. And that was rooted itself in our Lord's own words in Matthew 19, that he was speaking about eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. St. Paul speaks about celibacy again very strongly in 1 Corinthians 7, the undivided heart. In neither case were they referring exclusively or even maybe primarily to priests or the clergymen, but they were certainly talking about a charism that would be in the church, and that the church, that the Latin Rite Church, and really all the entire church for a long time understood to apply first and foremost to those who are called to stand at the altar in succession of in the continuation from the Old Testament, when the priests themselves had to live kind of periodic continence, even within marriage, before serving at the altar. So there was an understanding of the connection between the sacrifice of the Mass and the celibacy of the priest that goes way back. So there's a lot in there, and it certainly isn't out of the blue. It's certainly not something that was invented by a pope in the 11th century, and it's not, you know, there's a very strong, beautiful grounding of this charism in the life of the church.
Yes, and you know, I think of the Roman canon where we list the saints and martyrs, and there's the five virgin martyrs that we always talk about. So it's not just a male thing. Also, there's and that's very early in the church, that Agatha, Lucy, Anastasia, Cecilia, you know, that they were giving their virginity and pledging their bodies in that sense to the love of the Lord, you know. Let's get real basic and say, why is it that the priests and the Roman Rite are celibate? What's the basis of that?
I would say that it is primarily in the service of the priest's own pastoral ministry, that his priesthood is not primarily about a series of tasks. So celibacy is not about just sort of giving more time for the guy to work on, you know, his priestly work, but rather because not just what a priest does, but actually who the priest is. And I think primarily a priest is supposed to be an imitation of Jesus, standing in the place of Jesus, a spiritual father to his people, and that his heart should be reserved for his people, for his bride, the church. And we see that when a man is able to, and marriage, of course, is also an exclusive vocation. And so when you're talking about someone trying to live both, it does cause, I mean, it clearly can, the priesthood is not essentially celibate in one sense, because there are married men who are priests, obviously. Right. But in another sense, the priesthood is essentially celibate, because there is only one priest in the new covenant, and that is Jesus Christ. And he lived his life, he gave himself totally for us, he poured himself out, he himself was celibate, precisely in the service of his own priesthood, of his own paternity. And so I think we embrace celibacy primarily so that we can be a better spiritual father. And, you know, we can get into more of the details of that, but I think that's an important aspect of it anyway. And I think it's kind of the essential reason why, in my opinion. There are many other reasons. I think it's a tremendous witness to the culture around us, especially in a culture, as you have done such a beautiful job of highlighting, that is deeply wounded and broken through the ravages of the sexual revolution. And I think celibacy teaches us an awful lot about the dignity of human love, the dignity of marriage, the indissolubility of marriage, the need to protect and to care for children. You know, I mean, there's so many things about celibacy that is a beautiful witness, but I think that's actually secondary to how it helps him live out his own spiritual fatherhood.
So, I mean, what you said is so rich and has so many different facets to it. I'm reminded of something Father James Schall said to me one time years ago. And those of you who know Father Schall or knew Father Schall, he's deceased now, but we can remember him in this month of the dead, that he's certainly among the cloud of witnesses watching us here. But I remember him very plainly saying that in a period of time when the clergy live out their vows of celibacy well, it is easier for the married couples to live out their vows of fidelity well, and vice versa. So when the married couples are off doing crazy stuff, as a lot of people were in the 60s, then the culture that supports priestly celibacy is also undermined. And those two things are complementary, I guess we could say. Would you speak to that point?
Yeah, I think complementary and mutual reinforcing, perhaps, mm-hmm. to make it even stronger. You know, that I've heard before, it said that celibacy is the backbone of Catholic marriage. And I think, which sounds, of course, very kind of paradoxical and strange, like how could celibacy be the backbone of marriage? And yet I think it is, part because what celibacy shows, celibacy is a sacrifice of something very beautiful, what is very noble and very natural, which is the desire to have a wife and children on the part of a man. We're talking about priestly celibacy now. And inasmuch as it's a sacrifice of something beautiful, in some sense, the most beautiful thing, the most beautiful earthly good we've been given is that highest of all human friendships and marriage. And to sacrifice that is actually a kind of statement about the beauty of marriage, right? We don't sacrifice to God that which is lesser, but that which is greater. Right. And so the very sacrifice of marriage in itself points to the beauty of marriage. I think that's one aspect of it. The other is that on the other side of the spectrum, that's sort of showing, I suppose, that marriage is so beautiful and so noble and so exalted. On the other hand, celibacy also shows that there is something to which even marriage still points to, and that is the call of every human being to be united to God, right? A celibate priest, celibate woman is a walking sermon on the existence of God, and that all our human loves are supposed to be ordered towards God, even married love. And so in that sense, it's not only pointing to the majesty of marriage, but also the limitations of marriage. That is to say, we have put so much pressure on marriage to be the source of all our happiness, a kind of a weight that no marriage was ever intended to support. And celibacy says, no, in fact, as beautiful as your marriage is, it is ordered to something even greater. And both of you also need to be working on your relationship individually and through each other to God. So I think in those two ways, and in other ways too, but I think those two ways especially, it helps reinforce the beauty of Catholic marriage.
I think I would really like to hear you talk a bit about spiritual fatherhood. And there are a number of reasons why we need to be talking about spiritual fatherhood. The most immediate, of course, is all the crisis and controversy within the Catholic Church. But beyond that, I think people don't understand what fatherhood's all about. So if you could talk about that, I think it would be a huge help to just, what is a father? Why do we need fathers? And what is God saying to us when he gave us fathers?
Right. fantastic questions. You know, I think fatherhood and motherhood are ways that we share in the capacity of God, in the power of God to give life. You know, that he gives life as part of the overflowing of his goodness, the overflowing of his love into creation. And then part of that overflowing is actually endowing creatures with the capacity to share in that in different ways. Not just human beings, but in other ways, animals do, even plants do. They give life, they share in that capacity to give life. But the difference is that men and women take part in that in a way that is radical and unique, in a way that surpasses even the power of the angels, who do not share in God's generativity in that same way. And that is that human beings, in that act of procreation, we call it, you know, not just reproduction, not just a multiplication of the species, but in procreation, they actually share in God's creative power in such a way, because through their love, a new immortal soul comes into the world, which is something totally beyond their capacity to generate, right? That in their love, in their union, God enters into that union and endows that new creature with an immortal soul, which will live forever. And so that in itself is already a powerful demonstration of God's love for us and his desire to be a part of his creative plan. The sexual urge is so strong because God loves children. He wants children forever in heaven, right? And he wants us to be a part of that, to be a part of that plan of salvation and that plan of creation. So that I think is at a very basic level what motherhood and fatherhood is all about. Now, men and women, and I know you want to maybe try to get into this a little bit later, but sort of share in that generativity in a slightly different ways. A woman does so by receiving the child into herself, and a father does so by, in a more active and initiating way, of entering into the woman and bringing life through her. And in fact, the fatherhood of the man, which shares in the fatherhood of God in a unique way, is something that shows us that, in fact, a man has to learn how to be a father in a way that is somewhat distinct from the way that a woman receives her own motherhood. That motherhood is something that, in a sense, occurs more immediately and forcefully. John Paul II, in his beautiful letter to women, Mulieris Dignitatem, said that actually women share in God's generativity, I think he calls it generativity, in a fuller way, right? Because in their motherhood, they are actually fully mothers, whereas a man is a father in as much as he shares in the fatherhood of God. A man has to learn how to do that. It's been said before that fatherhood is a cultural achievement, you know, that we have to generate a culture that will actually generate fathers. Yes. And we've done a pretty poor job of that, as you pointed out very effectively, I think, in your work, and we need to do a much better job of that. And I think to get down to brass tacks, I think what a father does is I would identify three main aspects of, I'm talking about just natural fatherhood, and you know, which all these kind of then extend to supernatural fatherhood. But primarily, he serves as a provider for his family, as a guide and a teacher, and as a protector. And you know, we always have to be careful about making too harsh a kind of distinctions here. But I think that those are three of the qualities that characterize especially what a father is called to do, to be a provider, in as much as to speak very kind of basically and biologically. As the mother is taking care of the child at home, let's say in a society where there wouldn't be opportunities for women to work out, the man would go and bring back food. I mean, that's just kind of a basic biological need. Teaching and guiding, of course, the child in a way, for example, again, speaking very basically of teaching a child a trade or hunting and different things like that, and then being a protector, being the one who is basically expendable, you know, speaking, again, biologically, the man is far more expendable than the woman. And so having those three that then get kind of, in a sense, brought into rational man, those are still lived out today in fatherhood, and their complements are lived out in motherhood, and also in spiritual fatherhood. And so a spiritual father is one who provides and teaches and guides and protects. And I think celibacy, to get back to kind of where we started, is ordered to that. I think celibacy helps us live those aspects of fatherhood more effectively.
So the part that you just said about natural fatherhood and what natural fatherhood is and is all about, I think anyone of any faith can embrace and understand, you know, what you're talking about. But it's also, when you think about it, every one of those points, the sexual revolutionaries have attacked. I mean, the gender ideology is saying that men and women are, there's nothing essential about the differences between men and women.
You know, when I give talks, I give a lot of talks on gender issues and kind of transgender, gender dysphoria and things like that. And one of the points that I try to bring up is before diving into the kind of the weeds of that topic, to say, like, look, it's really important to see that we look at the world differently. These two, in a sense, understandings of gender dysphoria. And as Catholics, really, as kind of the, representing the, a more classical anthropology and a classical worldview, we see, as you were just saying, there are natures to things. There are realities to things. There is something that's out there, and the idea of truth is conforming our mind to something that's outside our bodies, to something that's outside of us. That's the idea of, I understand that properly, that I understand it truthfully. As opposed to a worldview which is much more common today, which has sometimes been called a liquid worldview, that everything is fluid and everything is subject to my own manipulation in a way that I can actually recreate not just the world around me, but even myself, right? I can say that I am no longer a man, now I am a woman, and that makes me a woman. That's a very different view of the world. And when that is applied to something as basic as manhood and womanhood, then we can imagine it would be applied to all kinds of other things as well, which are far less kind of malleable. And motherhood and fatherhood is among those, you know, that I think that there, that a lot of this misunderstanding of gender actually began in a failure to understand the differences between men and women and between motherhood and fatherhood itself.
This is what nominalism looks like.
Yes.
If you build a world around nominalism, this is what you get. You get drag queen story hours and, really aggressive and horrible medical interventions that are awful, you know, that are dangerous to the, that do not create human flourishing whatsoever, and you ignore all kinds of problems that do need to be addressed. So this is nominalism on steroids, you could say.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
One of the things that you said that I want to just emphasize is, fatherhood is not a list of jobs. Motherhood is not a list of jobs. And this was an old thing that was the sort of social science-y version of feminism. The first version of feminism, men and women are identical, except women are better. I mean, women do so much more work in the home, and this is so unfair. Well, the way they did that is that they would come up with a list of chores or things that involve taking care of children and all this stuff, and you should have a whole list of functions. And, oh gosh, women do more of that. And you could never really capture the essence of what the father does. When the father walks through the door and the kids are silent and respectful towards their mother, and he doesn't even have to say anything, he's just there. Yeah. You know, it didn't take him any time. There's no little box to check off, you know, to say that's what he did. So the idea of a person as a function, it's like we disaggregated ourselves into a list of jobs. We got to put ourselves back together as a whole person. And that's what I feel like your book is really doing, that around fatherhood, both for priests and for non-priests.
Yeah, you know, and I think too, you know, something you just said is, I think, really important, and that is, there are kind of two extremes that one can go to. I think one extreme is to say, you know, that there are these, that these differences are so kind of fundamentally fixed in biology, and there's going to be a very kind of a wooden understanding, even a stereotypical understanding of masculinity and fatherhood, of motherhood and fatherhood, of masculinity and femininity, of motherhood and fatherhood. And that clearly is wrong, because we see, even in just ordinary experience, there are going to be cases where, I mean, I just mentioned earlier about being a protector, for example. Well, obviously, you know, a mother is called to be a protector as well. You know, a mother is called to be a teacher as well, and a provider as well. And so we can't be too kind of wooden. On the other hand, we've become so fluid and flexible in our understanding of motherhood and fatherhood that we've ceased to see that in fact, they are both necessary, and they're both an important part of not just the raising of the children, but also that the dynamics of that relationship. And, you know, I mean, a way that has sometimes been described is that motherhood is more Eucharistic, you know, that she takes into her own self, you know, the life, and gives life from her own body. And fatherhood, I was trying to think of kind of the analogy for that. I think the fatherhood could be seen as maybe more apostolic, which is to say it's more outward and initiating, you know, and we can see that both of those are essential to the life of the church. In the aggregate. And I think in some ways, both of those are essential to the life of each one of us. Each of us needs a mother and a father in our own lives, and each of us needs to carry out our own motherhood or fatherhood.
Yes, that's really interesting. So I wonder if you could talk about this question of celibacy as optional within the Latin Rite, because this is a discussion that has been going on, obviously, at the Amazon Synod and a lot of other places. What's your thought process about that, Father Griffin?
Yeah, no, it's a terrific question, and I think it's a really important question to address. I would sort of go back again to the beginning that I think the priesthood is in fact celibate. So when we speak about optional celibacy, we're talking about a kind of certain understanding of that, right? When that there may be some who are called, even now, as you said, with Father Paul as a good example. I have other priest friends who are married from different avenues, the Anglican ordinariate and the pastoral provision and things like that. Orthodox priests, and yet I would say, and frankly, I think many of them would say that sort of celibacy is not the norm for the priesthood, right? And that they, I know some of their wives would say it.
Wait, celibacy is not the norm.
Celibacy is the norm for the priesthood. Thank you.
Yes, you know. Yes, Father Paul does say that. Father Paul does say, go ahead, yeah. Finish. I've heard him say that.
Yeah, right, right. And I, you know, sort of jokingly, a lot of their wives will say it, you know, especially, and that's, you know, and but sort of jokingly, but sort of not, you know, recognizing that it is a real challenge for a man to live the vocation of marriage and a vocation to priesthood well. So I think that to sort of say, well, first of all, when we say it's a discipline, we're not talking about a discipline that is equivalent to just something that can come and go based upon cultural needs and convenience and stuff like that, right? It's not a discipline in that sense. I mean, it's profoundly rooted theologically in our faith, and it's something that is essentially rooted in the priesthood, because, again, there's only one priest, and we all just share in his priesthood, and that's a celibate priesthood. So I think that's the context in which this discussion is made. I think we see examples of that even historically, that, again, I believe that it begins, you know, celibacy and perpetual continence begins in the apostolic age, that the great modification and variation from that happened in the East, in the Council of Trullo, where that was much more widely extended, some of those exceptions for ordinary married clergy, especially among the parish priests. Even in Eastern churches, it still would not be the case, and is still not the case in the monasteries and among the bishops. So there's an understanding that the priesthood is still, even in that sort of the high priesthood, even in these Orthodox and Eastern churches, is still celibate. So again, it's all that to say, it's not just a question of, well, it's no longer convenient, let's get rid of it, it's just a discipline. And I think that sometimes that is how the conversation goes. Like, well, why not just make it optional? And I mean, isn't that an obvious thing? You can't go wrong, you get more priests and, you know, and all these other benefits. I think the other thing that I would say is that I myself, and it's not just because I'm a convert, I've met, you know, cradle Catholics who feel the same way. You know, there is no way that I would have discerned this charism if it had been an option to be married.
Girlfriend,
and you know, and that's not like what we need to just force people to discern this. But no, I mean, I am so happy as a celibate priest. You know, the priest friends that I have are so happy. We would, and I think we've been able to serve people in a special way because of our celibacy. And I think the church would be poorer if we had if we didn't have a celibate clergy. And if we're putting these insuperable obstacles in the path of young men to discern this beautiful charism, which comes from the lips of our Lord, it seems to me that's not something that is just a neutral question of convenience, you know, that we're making it actually hard to receive this great gift that has given so much life to the church. Just imagine all the saints in history that have been celibate men and women. Imagine now making it really hard for them to have discerned that vocation. That's what optional celibacy does. And I just don't know if that's really the right answer. And by the way, I don't even know if it would work. You know, if the idea is to have more clergy, I mean, there's simply no evidence that that's going to be the case. Maybe in the short run, there'd be some, you know, additional, you know, members in the seminaries. But, you know, the archbishop in the Ukrainian Catholic Church, which has married clergy, came out with a warning before the document of the Amazon Synod saying, you know, this is not, you know, my words, this is not a silver bullet, right? We have clergy shortages too, and we have married clergy. You know, there are many Protestant denominations that struggle to find enough ministers. They have married clergy. So I think that people are looking at this in sort of a naive way and in a non-theological way, and frankly, in a non-human way, because how many men are going to be discerning this great charism if it's an option?
Right, right. And the other thing is that there's an undercurrent of sexual revolutionary ideology floating around.
Absolutely.
Which is that a normal person has to have sex. And so you guys must be not normal or something, you know, I mean, it's all very vague, but there's something about it that's offensive to the spirit of the age in which we live. You know, that's the Roman collar and the nun's habit that says celibacy. That's like, I think you used the term, it's like a walking billboard for something other than the sexual revolution, that's for sure. You know, whatever exactly that signals to people.
Yeah, I think that it's the reason why I believe so many people who are not Catholic, not Christian, not a believer in anything, are so interested in why I'm married or not. Because I sometimes wonder, like, why do you care? but I understand why they care. You know, they care because if I am happy and joyful and mature, and I'm able to live a life without sexuality, without sexual relations, and do so with a very rich fabric of relationships in my life and everything, that strikes at the very heart of one of the central dogmas of the sexual revolution,
right,
which is that everyone should have unrestricted access to sex, and any restraint on sex is necessarily unhealthy. And a joyful, mature, celibate priest says that is not true.
That's
because
right.
It isn't true. It's a
that's
lie.
That's exactly, you know? Right. That's exactly right.
And so I just think that that's another reason why celibacy is such an important witness in the world today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was thinking that very thing, that what the sexual revolution is saying is that everybody can do whatever they want, and yet we're shocked when people are abusive to one another.
Right.
You know, and the reality is that what the church is saying is that everyone needs to be in command of themselves. That a life of virtue involves that you are going to, there are some things you're not allowed to do. And right. Whether you're married or not married, there are certain things you're not allowed to do. And the spirit of the age is against that idea. And yet, true maturity is to be in command of yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, and true joy will come from being in command of oneself. And this is why, and I know this is maybe not the central point of this conversation right now, but this is why the sexual abuse crisis that we're going through right now is so heartbreaking. Because
yes.
It's right now when we need to be having that joyful witness more than ever. And even if whatever, I don't know the numbers, 95, 96, whatever, even if that many priests are being faithful and joyful in their vocation, I know the vast majority of priests are very happy as priests, as celibate priests, but it doesn't matter. If that message is not getting out and all that people are saying is that priests are kind of these bundles of repressed sexual energy that are exploding and hurting people, you know,
right.
All it's doing is giving more credence to those false dogmas of the sexual revolution.
So it's such a shame. So that brings me to another really important question. And we have been touching all sorts of fifth rails that you're not supposed to touch, because if you touch that rail, you'll explode. You're there in D.C. You know all about these things you're not allowed to touch. We're going to touch the really hot one here. Is celibacy the cause of the sex abuse crisis? A lot of people think that. And I there are a number of answers to that, but I'd like to hear your answer to that.
Yeah, yeah. I think that celibacy is not the cause of the sexual abuse crisis, at least not strictly speaking. And I think for this very reason, that celibacy is a way of living, a way of loving, that I think is very powerful. I've seen it in my own life and many other lives. I've been affected by many wonderful holy priests who are celibate. Celibacy itself is something that leads one into a deeper life of love and not less. And what we're seeing in the sexual abuse crisis is not a way of loving, but a perversion of that, a twisting of our way of loving. And the sexual abuse happens, as we know, far more commonly in families than anywhere else. You know, that the child abuse happens, you know, primarily, frankly, by stepfathers, you know, and mm-hmm. married men and women, you know, and that marriage is no kind of guarantee against sexual abuse either. And so celibacy, just as marriage is not a guarantee against it, nor is celibacy a cause of it. What I think is true about that statement, as I've been reflecting on this more and more, is that celibacy, you know, can provide kind of, when celibacy is not lived well, and when we're not holding priests accountable, and when priests are not holding each other accountable, and bishops are not doing their job in making sure that priests are held accountable, then celibacy opens up kind of a pathway where they have less accountability. I mean, the fact is that a married man at least has a wife at home, you know, and sometimes right. children at home, and there can be more immediate accountability there. For a celibate man, if he wants to escape that celibacy, you know, or misuse it or use it for his own selfish ends, there may be fewer people around to be accountable to hold him accountable. Also, celibacy opens up a space in a man's heart, which is a very beautiful place where he can sort of fill that with God and in the service of God. But he can also sort of fill it with all kinds of other things. I think that's true in every man and every person's case, but maybe especially true in a celibate. But no, I think celibacy is quite the opposite. I think that when we select for celibacy well, which we have not always been doing recently, when we form men well in celibacy, which we have not been doing well recently, when we hold men accountable in their priesthood to their celibacy, which we have not been doing well recently, if we did those three things, we would not be in the mess that we're in. And we wouldn't be having a conversation about optional celibacy or whether celibacy causes sex abuse crisis. The line that I've often used, I said that celibacy causes sex abuse in the same way that marriage causes adultery. I mean, it's true. There would be no marriage. There would be no adultery without marriage. But I mean, by getting rid of marriage in order to not have adultery, of course, we bring down a terrible tragedy upon the world. And I think right. the same thing is true for celibacy. We need to learn how to form and live celibacy better.
I want to go back to that accountability point that you made, because that is the heart of a huge amount of our problems right now. It's even stronger than what you said. It's not simply that the priests are not holding each other accountable. It's that in some places, the priests are actively encouraging one another and covering for one another and allowing it to be even worse.
Yeah, I think that we are reaping the fruits of, you know, I forgot who I was having a conversation with recently, but just that sort of corruption in the lay faithful and corruption in the clergy often go hand in hand. And I think we've seen that in the last 50 years, you know, as there has been more and more kind of license people have given to themselves, to their families, and to their children, and all the rest, you know, in the wider culture, in the sexual revolution, so too has there been a wink and a nod towards kind of the clergy in many cases, and towards each other, right? And I think that level of kind of complicity has caused a great deal of the pain that we're in right now. And I think now there are a lot who are trying to sort of climb out of this. I think, you know, I have the great joy of being in working in seminary formation. I think that's an important part of this, is really making sure that the next generation of priests are being formed well. And I know many, many seminaries that are doing an excellent job of that. We started up by talking about Mount St. Mary's, where there's just such fine work being done. There's so many good, holy, faithful young priests and the young seminarians. The future is very bright in that sense, but I think we have to begin there and do the best we can also to make sure that those, you know, among the older generations, many of whom are exceptional priests, but that those who shouldn't be in the priesthood anymore no longer are in the active ministry, because it's just, there's too much at stake and we can't play games with this anymore. And I hope that finally everyone has learned their lesson in that. I'm sure they haven't, you know, in every case, but I think we're closer. We've moved the ball down the field somewhat.
So I want, and we at the Ruth Institute are absolutely committed to moving that ball down the field in as many ways as we possibly can. And truth is the key thing to it. I want to talk about homosexuality. And mm-hmm. when I use the term homosexuality, I want to be really careful and say to everybody, anybody, that according to church teaching, there is no such thing as a homosexual person. Okay, there are homosexual tendencies, there are homosexual acts, there are homosexual feelings, there are a lot of stuff, but that's not a person's identity. But having said that, we have in the clergy many people who are, and Father Solon showed this, the percentage of people who self-identify as homosexual. If you ask a person, where do you fit on the homosexual spectrum? We have one survey, Father, from 2002 done by the Los Angeles Times, where priests were asked this question, where do you fit in on this spectrum? The more that the people said, yes, I'm on the homosexual end of things, okay, that was highly correlated, like 95% correlated with the incidence of clergy sexual abuse over the same period of time and stuff. So that is has been part of the Ruth Institute's contribution, is to show that correlation and how important it is. But it bears on the topic of fatherhood, right, and the motivations for entering the ministry and so on and so forth. So I'd like you to talk a bit about the longstanding instruction that men of strong homosexual tendencies are not to be ordained, and how that fits in with your overall discussion about celibacy and spiritual fatherhood.
Yeah, so this is one of these areas where I think there's been a lot of naivete in the last 50 years or so in terms of the selection and formation of men for the priesthood. And I'm so grateful both to Pope Benedict and also now to Pope Francis, both of whom have reiterated the Church's very strong statement about this, that the term that is used is deep-seated same-sex attraction. It's granted, it's not a clinical term. We don't have precise sort of, qualities that we're looking for there, and there's going to be a certain amount of variation as to how that's interpreted. But you're absolutely right. You know, that the data is there. It's in black and white that while certainly most men who have same-sex attraction in the priesthood, I think, have not been guilty of violating their promises and have not hurt anybody, nonetheless, it doesn't work the other way around. The vast majority of the abuse has not been towards little children, but to young men. It's been homosexual predatory behavior. And so we have to make sure that people who have this affliction, this deep-seated same-sex attraction, who are called to the same level of sanctity as you and me, and this can be a part of that journey towards holiness of carrying this cross, but they should not be in the priesthood, right? That this [S2] Right. [S1] is not the place for them, and for all kinds of reasons. And as you said, one of them, the most basic, is that a priest is called to be a spiritual father. And that means that a man entering into seminary formation has to have normal, natural, sexual, and human drives towards having a wife and children, because God takes those very natural desires and raises them in a supernatural way for him to live out, to become a spiritual husband to the Church and a spiritual father to the people of God. And so I think that there is a need for the basic and well-ordered sexual drives in a man entering the seminary. And in addition, it shouldn't be forgotten that, you know, celibacy is, it, part of its great spiritual value is in its sacrifice. And it's in the sacrifice of marriage that a celibate man is in part imitating the sacrifice of Christ. If celibacy is not a sacrifice because a man is not interested in marriage anyway, you know, understood obviously as marriage to a woman and having a family, then there's no sacrifice involved. That celibacy is supposed to be something that actually yields spiritual fruit for the people of God through that sacrifice. So I think those two things, in at least as a beginning of the conversation.
Yes, well, and when you have this conversation with other people within the Church, what kind of reaction are you getting from others?
You can imagine it's a pretty wide reaction. But I will say this, people have asked, well, what are some of the silver linings of, you know, this new iteration of the sexual abuse crisis 2018 edition, you know? And one of the advantages is that I find that I can speak about that with a lot more hope that it will be understood, you know, that it will be looked upon with greater favorability, that, you know, people will be more understanding. Yeah, there is a need to do this. Not always, not everywhere. It's not consistently everywhere, but I think there's a lot more people saying, yeah, we need to start taking these hard, you know, making these hard decisions. And it's really not fair. It's certainly not fair to the people of God. It's not fair to, you know, but it's also not fair to the man himself, right? To have him in formation or to ordain a man who is going to be living a life in which he could be, you know, put into positions of temptation and so forth that no one should be put in. You know, and we have to be conscious for their good as well as the good of the people of God.
So one thing I want to say about this is that the term gay is a term that I avoid using. And at the Ruth Institute, we try to avoid using that term because it covers so many different things. It's like it conceals more than it actually reveals. Mm. And so we have some people saying, well, gay priests have baptized you and gay priests have done this and that and the other thing. But we're never quite sure what is meant when the term gay is being used. Is this a person who's sexually active? Is this a person who has the feelings or just what? So in line with what you just said, I want to say that some of the holiest men I know are celibate men with strong same-sex attractions who are saying, I'm not gay. Gay is not my identity. I've had these feelings. I've done this thing. I've done these done this life. But for the sake of something better, I reject that. You know, that is not my identity. And those men, and they'll be the first ones to say, I shouldn't be ordained. I don't belong in the priesthood. You know, Daniel Madsen even wrote an article called Why Men Like Me Shouldn't Be Ordained, you know, expelling out a lot of what you just said, in addition to the whole point about temptation. But I want to just emphasize that for anybody who might be listening, who's dealing with same-sex attraction, that you are called to holiness also, and your path is going to be different than the path of a married woman or the path of an ordained priest. But you have a unique gift to offer the church, not in being gay, but in being holy. You know, that's the call, is to being holy. And everything that's not Christ has to go away. And certainly your same-sex attraction is not Christ. And so that has to go away. So, yeah, Dr. Morse's commercial. I hope that was clear. I hope people aren't confused about where I stand.
No, and I think that it's my experience in working with people with same-sex attraction is that when we help them see that not only is this not their identity, you know, but that they don't have to be slaves of these urges. There is something extremely liberating to when somebody says, like, I don't look at you as a gay person, right? I look at you as a beautiful child of God, a son of God, a daughter of God. That's certainly how God looks at you, you know, and to start to have that interior conversion where they start to see themselves more truly as God himself sees them, I think is an essential part of this. And then, like, giving them a way forward, you know, to sort of say that you're called to live a life not just of holiness, but also of joy, you know, and that one doesn't, it's one of the other advantages, by the way, of a celibate clergy, right, is that we're able to point to people and say, actually, you can live a very happy life, you know, and obviously it's going to look a little different than a lot of your friends who are getting married and having families, but just because it's different doesn't mean it has to be bad or it has to be dismal or it has to be despairing, right, and so giving people hope, I think, and I think just sort of saying, well, that's who you are, you know, you better give in, you better feed that, no matter how hard it is, no matter how, you know, painful it caught you, no matter how many, you know, how promiscuous your life becomes, like, that's all you have. You have no escape. You're a slave. I don't see how that's a source of joy for anybody, right? I think we have a great and beautiful message of freedom, and I think we just have to have the courage to say it.
You know, it doesn't work for straight people. Why would it work for gay people? You know, I mean, you know, in other words, acting on sexual compulsion is not fun, really. In the end, the sexual revolution's not fun, you know. So I actually, one of my books, I had a section called why recreational sex is not fun.
Yeah,
you might think that's a tough sell, but actually it's not. I wanted to go back to the seminarians and to your perspective on the seminarians. Tell us about the young men or the men currently in formation. What are they like compared to, well, it might be, I don't know how you want to analyze this, but I know that most Catholics are very interested to know who's in the seminary now, what are these guys like, and how do they compare to what we've been dealing with in the past?
Yeah. I can speak most clearly about the men who are at the seminary here. I think they're not that unusual from other seminaries around the country. There is a variety. I think religious orders will have maybe a slightly different feel to them in many cases. There are diocesan seminaries that are more or less kind of strong. But on the whole, I think seminaries are just so much stronger than they were even 20 years ago, let alone 40 years ago, when there was a lot of these problems were going on. And, you know, some of the seminaries were just disaster zones, you know, I mean, morally kind of bankrupt and everything else. But no, the men entering the seminary today continue to edify me, frankly. You know, I'm at a college seminary, so we have collegians as well as some pre-theologians who are men who have been out in the workforce for a few years, but we're in their first, this is their first experience of seminary. So these are guys who are kind of sort of right off the street, or right out of high school anyway, and some of them. And I find them to be incredibly generous, first of all. I mean, they're coming from a culture where this kind of generosity is not really encouraged, and yet they have generously, I think, resisted those trends. I find that they are all, I mean, basically without exception, faithful to the church. I mean, you would have to hunt far and wide, in my opinion, to find a truly dissenting seminarian, you know, who is dissenting from church, even the hard teachings of the church. even when they don't necessarily understand them entirely or cannot articulate them perfectly, that there is this deep sense of like of wanting to hold on to something strong. You know, I forget who it was that says that nobody wants to give their life for a question mark. You know, mm-hmm. they want to give their life to a church that stands for something, that is serious about proclaiming the gospel in an unadulterated way, and to receive the full fruits and the full beauty of the gospel, and not just the portions that are pleasant to understand or to pleasant to hear.
So I think they're not dissent. So they're mm-hmm. not entering the church in order to change the church or something like that.
Except in as much as they want to become holy and change the church by their holiness, you know, and that desire to become good, faithful, holy priests, I think is something that's very consistent and common. They come obviously from the spirit of the age, and, you know, they've drunk that, or they've breathed that atmosphere, as we all do, and sometimes there can be some self-focus and maybe some wounds from the past in terms of the use of the internet. You know, the average age right now of kids being exposed to the internet pornography is about 8 years old. Right. That's the average, you know. Right. So, you know, there's going to be some of that sort of thing. But again, with such good hearts, such good wills, a desire to be formed, a desire to receive correction, a desire to grow, I just find them to be a tremendous source of hope for the future. And I think we have a lot of really holy young priests today, and I think we have that for the future as well. So I think a lot of these things, I don't want to say like the sort of these problems will work themselves out, because the wounds are there, you know, the damage is there, and we can never forget that. But also I think it's important to keep in mind the hopeful side of what the future holds in store for us.
So one of the things that concerns me is that we've got these good, solid young guys coming along who are entering seemingly for the right reasons. But in a lot of the positions of power, we've got some of those older generations of people who are, excuse me, who are frankly trying to make one last stab for the spirit of Vatican II, or however you'd like to describe it. And so in a lot of cases, those people are their superiors to these young guys. And in some dioceses, not all dioceses have vocations, right? There's some places where right. vocations are thriving, and there's others where they're, you know, they're lucky to get one guy a year or something. Can you speak to that? That
sure.
tension? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think in this country anyway, I think that if you were to go, for example, to the NCDVD, which is a meeting of all the vocation directors around the country, there are about 200 vocation directors that show up to this thing. One would be very, very edified, I think, by the quality of the young guys who are serving as vocation directors. And those are in some ways the most important guys in the church, because they're right. kind of the gatekeepers, right? They're right. the ones who decide who is and who is. Now, obviously the bishop does eventually, but I mean, he would be the one who gives or doesn't give an application. He'd be the one who moves them forward or doesn't move them forward. And by and large, those are very, very young, solid guys. So I think that's a very good sign. I think seminary formation faculty on the whole, especially with the bigger seminaries, is just very solid, you know? And so even if there are some where you have bishops, or even in some places, say vicars general, and in a few places like where you have seminary faculty who are kind of on that last gasp, I think of a kind of a tired and sterile approach to doctrine, which has no future in my opinion. I just don't know how much influence they have, you know, in the day-to-day actual lives of these young guys. Now, that's not everywhere. It's not universal. There are still places where that happens, I think, where you have superiors of generous young men who aren't really, you know, on board in the right sense. And I also, even in those cases, I would say that the young man is not as helpless as it might first seem. He has not only probably a young priest that he knows around him, you know, who can be an inspiration and a motivation for him to continue forward on the right path. But we also have, and I think we can never forget this, you know, we're not a fly-by-night kind of operation. You know, the church has been around for an awful long time, and there are many wonderful saints from our past that we can look to, and their writings and their example and their prayers from heaven. And I've seen it happen where, you know, young guys kind of exposed to a very mediocre kind of indifferent environment can come out and be stronger than ever, right? Because they've learned how to be in union with the Lord, and they have been in touch with his friends, the saints, and they've in a sense had to sort of form themselves. By no means is that an ideal situation, but it does happen, right? And so mm-hmm. I think where it's harder, in my opinion, what's harder than kind of mediocre faculty is mediocre seminarians, right? That, I think, which is no longer the case, in my opinion, in the vast majority of seminaries, that's where I think we got into so many of these problems in the past, where you sort of have seminarians corrupting other seminarians, right? And I think that is, which is, of course, not mediocre, but actually vicious. And that actually happens, you know, in many places. I think that would be far less common in diocesan seminaries in the United States. I think that might still be happening in some parts of the world. I don't know. I've just heard that by hearsay. Maybe it's happening in some smaller formation houses of religious orders. But I think overall the picture is pretty strong. And I think the strongest thing about a seminary today are our guys, brother seminarians.
Yes. And so there was recently this survey that was done by at Notre Dame in cooperation with the people at Georgetown and stuff. And it had great results. Only 6% of the seminarians said that they had ever been sexually harassed or abused or anything like that, which was a wonderful result. But less than half of the seminaries actually participated in it. And what do you think that's about? Do you have any sense about that? Or did you guys participate in it at your place?
I don't know the answer to that question. I think it was only for major seminaries, but I'm not sure. We're a college seminary, so I really am not sure. Okay. I know I certainly didn't participate, and I would have. And I would love to have had our guys be able to respond to it, because I think it would have been a very, very positive side of that thing. But I don't really know why. All I can say is sort of anecdotally, my experience in talking to seminarians from different parts of the country is that that these sort of things are something that which defined a lot of seminaries at one time are just not defining their experience anymore.
So let me wrap up our time together by asking you this question. What can our viewers do that would be helpful? We always like to give our people action items. You know, what can we do that's positive, that's helpful? So I want to say everybody should read your book. Why don't you hold up that book? It's a great book. Mine's on the Kindle. Sure. So this is what it looks like on a Kindle.
This is what the non-Kindle version looks like.
Celibacy. You know, you should get this book. You should read it. You should share it with your bishop, your vocations director of your diocese or wherever you might be. And you should read it for yourself too. So that's my idea of an action item, is everybody should read your book. But is there anything specific that you could mention that people could do, that the faithful can do, that would be helpful to people in your position and to the seminaries and the general formation?
You know, I honestly do believe that the lay faithful have more influence in the lives of their priests than they may realize. And that just by not only their prayers and sacrifices, which are the foundation of it all, but also by their words of encouragement, and even sometimes their words of kind of calling fatherhood out of a priest. I think sometimes priests can get locked into this very functional, administrative, bureaucratic view of his own vocation. And sometimes it takes the well-placed word of a lay person to remind him that he is his or her spiritual father, you know, and that sometimes, you know, I think that's what, frankly, what wives often, you know, young mothers need to do with young fathers. You know, somehow it's that well-placed word which draws fatherhood out of him. As we were saying earlier, that motherhood is something that sort of happens almost very, very, very naturally, and that sometimes fatherhood has to be formed and inculcated. And oftentimes it's the mother of his own child who does that and calls fatherhood out of him. And I think in an analogous way, the people of God can do that with the priest. So I think that's one thing. I think the other thing is, you mentioned seminaries and formation. My hope is that seminaries become more and more a place where natural fathers, and incidentally natural mothers too, who also bring us a sort of a special take on generativity, but bringing them into the seminary formation to give them an opportunity to help form the future generation of spiritual fathers. Because one of the most beautiful things that I found in my studies is that natural fatherhood is not supposed to be limited only to natural fatherhood, but that natural fathers are also supposed to be spiritual fathers, primarily of their own children, as our mothers, spiritual mothers of their own children, to helping them get to heaven. And so we're, in a sense, we're in this together, and that we, in our spiritual motherhood and fatherhood, sort of share those gifts with each other. And help to form our future spiritual father. So I think there's something to be said too to having additional lay involvement in certain aspects of the seminary formation program, where we have so much to learn from those who have been out in the field for a long time, bearing the heat of the sun, and being good moms and dads and spiritual mothers and fathers. And I think all of us can learn a great deal from them. So I think there's a lot to be done, and I think we can do it together.
Well, thank you. That's a very great place to end our conversation. Father Carter Griffin, I very much appreciate your time with us. Thank you.
Dr. Borth, thank you.
You've been watching the Dr. J Show, featuring a personal interview with Father Carter Griffin. Ruth Institute President and Founder Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse noted, "To properly assess the sexual abuse scandal which has plagued the Catholic Church for decades now, certain issues must be confronted with an uncompromising commitment to learning the truth wherever it leads us, even if that truth is politically incorrect." And now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week.
We're not here just to talk. We're here to get something done. So you need to buy this book, Why Celibacy, by Father Carter Griffin. You need to read it yourself. You need to share it with your priest, your bishop, your seminary rector. Buy those books. Give them away as presents. It'll be a great Christmas gift. The fellows will really feel supported by you doing that. Secondly, if you're a member of the Sarah Club is a Catholic organization devoted to encouraging and supporting vocations to the priesthood. You definitely need to be getting this book and sharing this book with people. If you're not in the Sarah Club, share the book with somebody who is. And finally, take to heart the final words that Father Griffith said to us, which is that we as lay people can certainly be part of supporting our clergy. We can support our priests and call out of them their spiritual fatherhood. Thank you very much for watching this episode of the Dr. J Show. Now let's go get it done.
And that's our action item for this week.
It is literal torture, soul murdering torture, every day.
Every day of my life, I think about running my car into a pole or off of a bridge.
It's the fear of what I haven't discovered yet, because I have vivid memories, but also I have moments in time where I can't remember a thing.
We all felt like we were alone because we couldn't talk about this because of the gag order. Nobody should live like this with this pain. My hope is that the Catholic Church is no longer silent, that they will open up the floodgates of those secret archives and just bring justice to these people.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.